Harper Audio presents War Cry by Wilbur Smith with David Churchill, read by Sean Barrett. 2 months had passed since war had been declared, and the autumn sun that shone down from the clear blue skies over Bavaria was so glorious that it seemed to cry out for beer to be drunk and songs to be sung in hearty, joyful voices. But the Oktoberfest had been cancelled, and the double Phaeton limousine proceeding up the short drive of the villa in Grunwald, just outside Munich, bore tidings that were anything but joyous. The car pulled to a halt. Its chauffeur opened the passenger door to allow a distinguished gentleman in his late 60s to disembark, and a uniformed butler admitted him into the house. A moment later, Atala, Countess of Meerburg, looked up as the family lawyer Victor Solomons was shown into the drawing room. His hair and beard might now be silver, and his stride was less vigorous than it had once been, but the impeccable tailoring of his suit, the gleaming white of his perfectly starched collar, and the flawless shine of his shoes reflected a mind that was still as precise, as sharp, and as insightful as ever. Solomon stopped in front of Atala's chair, gave a respectful little nod of the head, and said, "Good morning, Countess." His mood seemed subdued, but that was only to be expected, Atala reminded herself. Solomon's beloved son, Isidore, was away at the front. No parent could ever be light-hearted, knowing that their child's very survival now lay at the mercy of the gods of war.
"Good morning, Victor. What an unexpected pleasure to see you. Do please sit down."
Atala extended a dainty hand towards the chair opposite her. Then she turned her attention towards the butler, who had shown the guest in, and was now awaiting further instruction.
"Some coffee, please, Brown, for Herr Rechtsanwalt Solomons. Would you like some cake, Victor? A little strudel, perhaps?"
"No, thank you, Countess."
There was a somber tone to Solomons's voice, Atala realized, and he seemed uncharacteristically reluctant to look her in the eye.
"He has bad news," she thought. "Is it the boys? Has something happened to one of them?"
She told herself to remain calm. It would not do to betray one's fears, especially not while a servant was still in the room.
"That will be all, Brown," she said.
The butler departed. Atala felt a sudden desire to postpone the bad tidings for just a few seconds.
"Tell me, how is Isidore getting on? I hope he's safe and well."
"Oh, yes. Very well, thank you, Countess," Victor replied with a distracted air, as though his mind was not fully engaged.
But he took such pride in his beloved son that he could not resist adding,
"You know, Isidore's division is commanded by Crown Prince Wilhelm himself. Imagine that. We received a letter from him just last week to say that he has already seen his first action. Apparently, his major declared that he conducted himself admirably under fire."
"I'm sure he did. Isidore is a fine young man. Now, what is it, Victor? Why are you here?"
Solomons hesitated a second to gather his thoughts, and then sighed.
"I fear there is no other way of saying this, Countess. The War Office in Berlin informed me today that your husband, Graf Otto von Meerbach, is dead. General von Falkenhayn felt that it was better that you should hear the news from someone you knew than simply receive a telegram message or a visit from an unknown officer."
Atala slumped back against her chair, eyes closed, unable to say a word.
"I know this must be very distressing," Solomons went on. But distress was actually the last thing on her mind. Her overwhelming feeling was one of relief. Nothing had happened to her sons. And, finally, after all these years, she was free. There was nothing that her husband could do to hurt her anymore.
Atala controlled herself. She had been trained from her earliest girlhood to compose her fine porcelain features into an image of calm, aristocratic elegance, no matter what the circumstances. It was now second nature to hide her true feelings behind that mask. just as the waters of a pond cover the constantly paddling feet that enable a swan to glide with such apparent ease across its glittering surface.
"How did he die?"
she asked. "In a near crash. I have been informed that His Excellency was engaged in a mission of the greatest importance to the German Empire. Its details are classified, but I am authorized to inform you that the crash occurred over British East Africa. The Count was flying aboard his magnificent new airship, the Assegai. This was her maiden voyage."
"Did the British shoot him down then?"
"I do not know. Our ambassador in Bern was informed by his British counterpart merely that the Count had died. This was a gesture of courtesy in honor of your late husband's eminence. I gather, however, that the British do not have any Royal Flying Corps units in Africa, so we must assume that this was an accident of some kind. The gas used to elevate these dirigibles can apparently be very unstable."
Atala looked Solomon straight in the eye and very calmly said,
"Was she on board the Assegai at the time?"
The lawyer did not need to be told who she was, nor for that matter would anyone remotely acquainted with German high society. Count von Meerbach had long been a notorious philanderer, but in recent years he had become obsessed with one particular mistress, a ravishing beauty with lustrous sable hair and violet blue eyes, called Eva von Velberg. The Count had begged Atala to divorce him so that he could make the Velberg woman his wife, but she had refused. Her Catholic faith would not allow her to end her marriage. And so they had come to an arrangement. Countess Atala lived, with their two young sons, in her perfectly proportioned classical villa in the chic little town to the southwest of Munich, where the smartest elements of Bavarian society could be found. Meanwhile, Count Otto had retained his family castle on the shores of the Bodensee. And there he kept his mistress, or, as Atala thought of her, his whore, and saw his sons on the rare occasions he was able, or remotely willing to spare the time to attend to them. "The Assegai was housed within the grounds of the Meerbach Motorworks," Solomon said, referring to the gigantic industrial complex on which the family fortune was based. "I am told by senior company officials who were present at the airship's departure that a woman was seen going aboard her. I was also informed by the War Office that the Assegai went down with all hands. No one survived."
Atala allowed a slight bitter smile to cross her face.
"I will not even pretend to be sorry that she is dead."
"Nor can I pretend to criticize you for that. I am well aware how much you have suffered on her account."
"Dear Victor, you are always so kind and so fair. You were..."
She paused to correct herself.
"You were my husband's lawyer, yet you have never done anything to hurt me."
"I am the family's lawyer, Countess," Solomons gently corrected her. "And as long as you were and remain part of the von Meerbach family, then I will always consider you my client. Now, may I ask, are you ready to discuss any of the consequences of your husband's tragic demise?"
"Yes, yes, I am," said Atala.
And then, for reasons she could not quite explain, she suddenly felt the loss to which she had been numb up to that point. For all that she had suffered, she had always prayed that one day her husband might see the error of his ways and devote himself to his family. Now all hope of that had gone. She began to cry and started rummaging through the bag at her feet, trying to find a handkerchief. "May I?" asked Solomons, reaching into his pocket. She waved him away, shaking her head, not trusting herself to speak. Finally, she found what she was looking for, pressed the handkerchief to her eyes, dabbed her nose, took a deep breath and said,
"Please forgive me."
"My dear Countess, you have just lost your husband. Whatever difficulties you may have faced, he was still the man you married, the father of your children." She nodded and ruefully said,
"It seems that I do not have a heart of stone after all."
"I, for one,
never supposed that you did. Not for a single moment. She gave him a nod of thanks and then said,
Please continue. I believe you were going to describe the consequences of...
She could not bring herself to use the word death, and so just said,
Of what has occurred?
Quite so. There cannot be a funeral, sadly, for if the body has been recovered, the British will by now have buried it.
My husband died serving his country overseas,
Atala said, straightening her back and resuming her air of poised composure.
That is to be expected.
Indeed. But I think it would be entirely appropriate, indeed expected, to have a service of remembrance, perhaps at the Frauenkirche in Munich, or you may feel that either the family chapel at Schloss Meerbach or even a service at the motorworks would be more appropriate.
The Frauenkirche, said Atala without a moment's hesitation. I don't think a factory is a suitable location at which to commemorate a count of the German Empire, and the chapel at the Schloss is too small to accommodate the numbers of people who will wish to attend. Could someone from your firm liaise with the Archbishop's office to secure a suitable date and assist with the administration of the event?
Of course, Countess, that would be no trouble. Might I suggest the Bayerischer Hof for the reception after the service? If you give the hotel manager your general requirements, the hotel staff will know exactly how best to provide exactly what you need.
I'm afraid I can't even begin to think about that just now.
Atala closed her eyes, trying to put the jumble of thoughts and emotions in her head in order, and then asked,
What will become of my sons and I?
Well, the extent and variety of the Count's possessions mean that his will is unusually complex. But the essential facts are that the family estate here in Bavaria and a majority share in the motorworks all go to your eldest son, Konrad, along with the title of Graf von Meerbach. Your younger son, Gerhard, will have a smaller shareholding in the company. The various properties and the income they generate will be held in trust for each son until he is 25. Prior to that point, they will each receive a generous allowance, plus the cost of their education, of course. Any additional expenditure will have to be approved by their trustees.
And who will they be?
In the first instance, you and I, Countess.
My God, fancy Otto allowing me such power.
He was a traditionalist. He felt that a mother should take charge of her children's upbringing. But you will note that I said, in the first instance. Once Konrad is 25 and takes control of the family's affairs, he will also assume the role of trustee to his brother, who will then be 18 years old.
So for 7 years, Gerhard will have to go cap in hand to Konrad if he ever needs anything?
Yes. Atala frowned. It worries me that one brother should have so much power over the other. His Excellency believed very strongly that a family, like a nation, required the strong leadership of a single man.
Didn't he just? I take it that I am provided for.
Oh, yes, you need not worry on that score. You will retain your own family money, added to which you will keep all the property, jewellery, artworks, and so on, that you received during your marriage, and receive a very generous annual allowance for the rest of your life. You will also have a place on the board.
I don't care about the damn board, Atala said. It's my boys that I worry about. Where are we meant to live?
It is entirely up to you whether you wish to reside here in Grünwald, or at Schloss Meerbach, or both. His Excellency has set aside monies that are to be spent on the maintenance of the castle and its estate, and on employing all the staff required to maintain the standards he himself demanded. You will be the mistress of Schloss Meerbach once again, if you choose to be so.
Until Konrad's 25th birthday.
Yes, he will be the master then.
When Solomon's had gone, Atala went upstairs to the playroom where Gerhard was playing. She looked on him as a gift from God, an unexpected blessing whose birth had brought a rare moment of joy to a marriage long past rescuing. Gerhard had been conceived.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.